All right, well, welcome. We will go ahead and get started here. It's my great privilege to welcome all of you to the 2017 Dermot McGlinchey Lecture on Federal Litigation. This lecture honors a remarkable graduate of this law school whose achievements and generous spirit continue to shape all who pass through this building. Born in New York City, Dermot McGlinchey received his undergraduate and law degrees from Tulane, graduating from the Tulane Law School class of 1957. While a student, he left his mark at this law school, literally, in the back of this room on the marble, for winning our moot court competition. But then he went on to leave his mark at this law school and on this campus in many other ways as well, through a lifetime of dedicated service to this institution and to the bar and the city and the broader community. For the next 36 years after his graduation, Mr. McGlinchey built a towering career in the private practice of law. And throughout all of those 36 years, he gave back at every turn. At Tulane, he served as the president of the university's Alumni Association, chair of the development committee for the Dean's Council here at the law school, vice chair of the endowment program that built the Tulane Maritime Law Center, and chair of the law school's building fund, to which we owe this magnificent building. As a leader of the Louisiana Bar, Mr. McGlinchey tirelessly promoted equal access to the courts and helped to create the Louisiana Bar Foundation's pro bono project, which continues to be a national leader to this day. Last year, we were enormously proud to celebrate Mr. McGlinchey's legacy by inducting him into the Tulane Law School Hall of Fame, recognizing his stellar professional achievements and his unsurpassed devotion to Tulane. The lecture we hold in his honor today reflects another important legacy as well, because it was created and endowed by his partners and colleagues at the McGlinchey Stafford Law Firm he helped to found and build into one of the nation's finest. Founded in 1974, the firm now boasts 200 lawyers in six states, stretching from Texas to New York. After McGlinchey's passing in 1993, at the age of 60, his partners founded this lecture series in his honor through the firm's charitable foundation. Since that time, this annual lecture has been consistently one of the marquee events in the intellectual life of our law school, drawing some of the nation's most eminent jurists, scholars, and practitioners to this podium. And today we are tremendously pleased to continue that tradition by welcoming Professor Jack Balkin from Yale Law School. We're also honored today to be joined by Mr. McGlinchey's wife, Ellen, and also by the wife of Graham Stafford, Ann Stafford. So welcome. We're so grateful to you for your faithful support of this lecture series coming out year in and year out. It's and often hosting at your home, and so it's a family tradition that we treasure and greatly appreciate. We're also very honored to be joined by many members of the McGlinchey Stafford firm who are here. And so we thank you. I ask you to join me in thanking them, both the firm and the McGlinchey family, for their continued support of this series and the law school. I will now turn over the podium to introduce tonight's distinguished speaker, to Professor Steve Griffin. Professor Griffin holds an Irby chair here at the law school and is also the Rutledge C. Clement Professor of Constitutional Law and formerly Interim Dean and Vice Dean of the law school. Thank you, Steve.
Thanks very much, and thank you to all for coming, especially to those, my students, and the audience. So, Professor Jack Balkin, as you can tell from the giant screens behind me, is a Knight Professor of Constitutional Law and the First Amendment at Yale Law School. I usually try to say something a little more personal about the speaker each time, since you can read about his accomplishments in the program. I think what I would emphasize about Professor Balkin is that he is something of a legal polymath. As you might be able to glean from his publication record, he is equally at home publishing in scholarly books and journals, on his blog, Balkanization, which I occasionally blog on myself, and op-eds and articles for some of our leading journals of opinion, and important works that are really designed for a broad audience. As you might be able to also glean from his lecture tonight, he is a sort of a unfailingly affable individual, an ideal intellectual companion. So I think we're sort of in safe hands tonight. What I wanted to specifically add, though, was a recommendation for perhaps Professor Balkin's best book, which I actually brought here to you. It's called Living Originalism. I consider myself to have high standards, and so I don't often recommend books unreservedly. But this is one book I would recommend to anyone interested in American constitutional law. Technically, I suppose it's a work of constitutional theory. And theory is a word that puts off some people. But I would, again, recommend it to anyone interested in the law. It's an outstanding example of someone who's putting great intelligence to work on a series of problems that has sort of vexed and baffled people really for decades. And it does something really unusual, which it actually makes progress on those problems. And that's the reason it has my high recommendation. So I turn the floor over to Professor Balkin.
How is everybody today? Good, I'm glad. I want you to stay happy, because I'm going to be talking to you for about 40 minutes. And I don't know. I think I'm entertaining, but I don't know. We'll see. I called this lecture Constitutional Time. And the reason I called it Constitutional Time is that one of the things Steve didn't mention is I wrote a book, a commentary on the ancient Chinese classic of changes, the Book of Changes, which was published in 2002. And this book says that the most important thing to understand is what is the time. What time is it? Because you're supposed to make your life and your actions and your behavior be in harmony with the times. You have to understand what the times are, and if you act in harmony with them, then everything will go well, and if you don't act in harmony with them, then things will not go well. And so this is the same question we could ask about anything, including our lives as citizens in this great country. What time is it? What is the character of the time in which we're living right now? So everybody has this on their minds. Obviously, we've had a very exciting election season. And now we have a very exciting first month or so of a new administration. And everyone is asking, what is happening? How do we understand the nature of this time? So that's what this lecture is about. All right. Well, it turns out that I am not going to spend most of my time talking about the ancient Chinese Book of Changes. Instead, I'm going to talk about some work by some colleagues of mine at Yale, both of whom, in very different times, tried to make sense of the cycles of American history, and in particular, changes in our Constitution. And I'm going to apply their ideas, and I'm going to say some more things about them, and then I'm going to end the lecture, if I have time, we'll see, by going back to a very ancient vision of time, which is the vision that the classical writers had about the rise and life and decline and fall of republics. They thought deeply about this question, and what they had to say then is relevant to our times now. So let's begin. I'm going to begin by talking about my dear friend Bruce Ackerman, who has a theory about how revolutions occur within the American constitutional tradition. And he argues that, in fact, the United States has had three republics. Each is sort of a new beginning, a revolution, but we don't understand them as revolutions. We understand them as continuities. He says there's a republic that goes from the founding to the Civil War, from the Civil War to the New Deal, and from the New Deal to the present. And he argues that there are these moments, constitutional moments, of deep, intense deliberation by the public that lead to the public's decision that they want to go off in a different direction. And they change the nature of the constitutional pact, but they do so outside of the amendment process. That's his view. Now, that's one possible way of understanding what is currently happening to us. One possible way of understanding what is currently happening to us is that we're in the middle of such a deliberative moment. Now, there are puzzles about the way that Ackerman articulates his view. He has changed his mind about what constitutes a revolution or a constitutional moment. He didn't used to think that the civil rights era was such a moment. Now he does. He has never accepted the idea that the success of the women's rights movement constituted such a moment. Who knows what will happen? Maybe he'll change his mind. And he's never thought that the election of Ronald Reagan in 1980 signaled a significant change in the constitutional meanings. But maybe he'll change his mind again. This is something he and I differ about, because I have a different way of thinking about the stages of change in our constitutional system. I think about regimes. I'll get to that in a second. In his view, what has been happening is that the conservative movements that usher in Ronald Reagan in 1980 have been trying to fundamentally change constitutional values in the United States. And so they've tried over and over again to create this kind of magical moment that occurred at the founding, during Reconstruction, and during the New Deal. But each time, for complicated reasons, sometimes bad luck, sometimes bad strategy, they've been beaten back. So in his view, what's currently happening now is one more chance to try to scale the mountain, one more chance to try to change the nature of the constitutional pact, and it's being led by the current president, Donald Trump. So that's one possible way of understanding what's happening. If that's right, then we're going to be subjected to an extended period of time. A proposal has been placed before us. We're going to debate that proposal. It will be a proposal about a set of values. What those values are, we can only dimly see. They probably have something to do with nationalism. They probably have something to do with trade. They probably have something to do with religion, right? But anyway, this proposal is being placed in front of us. We're going to have a long debate over it. And then if in turn this proposal is accepted, then it will change the way the Constitution looks going forward. Now, that's his understanding of how to understand what's going on at this point in time. I don't think, in fact, that's the right way to understand what's happening. And the reason is very simple. When these have happened, these kinds of events have happened, they've been usually ushered in by a landslide election. Or there's been a landslide election that's occurred very, very shortly thereafter. That doesn't seem to describe what happened recently. Now, it's possible that in the next couple of years we'll have such a landslide election. And if that happens in 2018 or 2020, then we'll change our mind. We'll look at everything very differently. But right now, it looks like something that seems a little different. It doesn't seem to fit this storyline. But that is, if Bruce is right, that is the way you would look at the question. You would look at the next couple of elections and see whether or not the folks that support President Trump basically win over most of the country, and they get a landslide like FDR got in 1936, or that LBJ got in 1964, something like that. So that's what you would look at. I think there's a different way to look at this. So I'm going to turn to another colleague of mine who is not a constitutional theorist, but is a study of presidents and presidential leadership. His name is Steve Skowronek. He's been very influential among lawyers who think about constitutional development. And I'll explain why in a second. But the first thing to understand is he thinks about the history of the United States very differently. His view is that you can think about the history of the United States in terms of a series of regimes. Now, what is a regime? A regime is basically a period in which one of the political parties is dominant, even if it doesn't win all the elections, and basically it structures the background agenda of politics. That is, what are the issues that are on the table? What is it that seems possible? And what is it that doesn't seem possible at any point in time? And generally speaking, political scientists, although they have different theories, different views, they tend to converge on the idea that there have been a limited number of these regimes in American history. There is the regime begun by President Washington, which is dominated by the Federalist Party, the regime that's begun by Thomas Jefferson, which is dominated by the Republican Party, or the Democratic Republican Party, as it's sometimes called, the regime that begins with Andrew Jackson, which creates what we now call the Democratic Party, the regime that begins with Abraham Lincoln, that creates the Republican Party, and lasts for a very, very long time, until the regime created by FDR, which ushers in the New Deal, in which the Democratic Party is the dominant party. And that actually also includes the Civil Rights era, which is also part of it. So it's called the New Deal Civil Rights regime. And then finally, the regime we live in today, or at least that's what I think, which is the regime that was created by Ronald Reagan in 1980. And basically, the Republican Party is the dominant party. It sets the agenda of politics. And it is basically ushered in by the rise of the conservative movements that happened in the 70s and 80s. And we're still living in that regime right now. At least that's what I think is going on in American politics. Now, Skowronek agrees with this regime model, but he's interested in the rise and fall of these regimes. And he's also interested in the role that presidents play in these regimes. Now, I'm a constitutional scholar. You know, I like talking about presidents as much as the next person. But what I really care about is the way people think about the Constitution and how it changes during these regimes. And if you think about the difference between the way people think about the Constitution in 1890 and the way they thought about the Constitution in 1940, it's a big difference, because by 1940 we've had the New Deal, very, very different notion of federal power, very, very different notion of civil rights. All these things change, and they reflect a change in the regime between the earlier regime dominated by the Republican Party for many years and the New Deal civil rights regime dominated by the Democratic Party. So that's why I care about it. But let me take you a little further into what Skowronek is after. He says that within each regime, you have presidents of different parties, and each president in those parties, each president within the regime, his fate, what he can do and what he can't do, the opportunities for leadership available to him and the opportunities therefore closed to him, is shaped by what the president before him did and the president before him did. That is, you walk in not on a blank slate, but by a politics that's been shaped by the immediate predecessors in the presidency, in the White House. And so what he says is that regimes rise and fall as the dominant party, started by a new president, basically takes over politics, but eventually it's the regime cracks, the coalition falls apart, and eventually it creates an opportunity for a new regime. So here's an example of how Skowronek thinks about it, and he divides presidents into four categories. He says, when you are elected to the White House, you can show up under one of four conditions. You can show up when the regime, the dominant regime, is powerful and strong, or when it's weak and debilitated. Or, and you can also show up when you're allied with that regime, or when you're opposed to it. So that's a box of four. Four different situations. And to explain that, I'm going to talk to you about four presidents, one after the other. Each one is a different kind of president. Each one reflects these ideas. Jimmy Carter, elected in 76. Ronald Reagan, elected in 1980. George H.W. Bush, elected in 1988. And Bill Clinton, elected in 1992. They represent the sort of box of four. Let me explain what I mean. Let's start with Reagan. Reagan is elected in 1980. The New Deal civil rights regime, dominated by the Democratic Party, is running on fumes. It's running on empty. The economy is in terrible shape. People are tired of the way things are. Reagan comes in. He smashes the orthodoxy of his time. He establishes a new regime. He basically creates the modern Republican Party as we know it. So he's a reconstructive figure. He is a person who is opposed to the existing regime, that is the New Deal civil rights regime, at a time when it's at its weakest. He's reconstructive. He repudiates and reconstructs a new regime. He is followed by his vice president, George H.W. Bush. George H.W. Bush is what we would call an affiliated president. He is a person who enters the White House affiliated with a regime while it is still robust and strong. He sees himself as the loyal follower of Ronald Reagan, Ronald Reagan's third term, it was sometimes said, and his job is a very peculiar one. His job is to keep all the factions of this party, now dominant party, together, because as soon as people succeed, guess what happens to them? They start fighting among themselves. Each of them says, well, I was with you and I supported you while we were trying to get up the hill. You know, we were all unified, but now we're there. Now, what are you going to do for me? And so there are different factions within a group, and they all want their thing, and some of them are happy with where they've gotten, and some of them get a little more radicalized, and some of them want to go off in this direction, some of them go off in that direction. And so when you're a president like George H.W. Bush, you have a problem. The problem is, how do you simultaneously follow the path that was set forward by the previous regime, by Ronald Reagan, and how do you keep all these squabbling folks in your party together so that you can make some progress? And how do you avoid having them gang up on you and get rid of you? Because, in fact, even in a presidential system like ours, presidents are always having to fight off not just opponents in the opposite party, but opponents in their own party. Well, as you saw, George H.W. Bush, he did a pretty good job, but he had a lot of problems, and he was attacked viciously, not only by the people in the opposite party, by his own party, because of decisions he made about taxes and various other decisions he made. And he ultimately, although he was very successful in foreign policy, he only served one term. He's followed by Bill Clinton. You may all remember Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton is the third kind of president. He is somebody who is oppositional to the dominant party. He's a Democrat, the first Democrat elected after Ronald Reagan. And he is taking power when that regime is still very robust and powerful. So he's a Democrat taking power when the dominant party is the other party. So that makes him like Dwight Eisenhower, or like Richard Nixon, or like Grover Cleveland, who you don't remember, or like Woodrow Wilson. These are called preemptive presidents. Why are they called preemptive presidents? Because here's the problem. You're now the president, but the tides of politics are really pushing against you strongly. You're swimming against the tide. You are basically fighting not only the opposition party, but public opinion, the basic tenor of what people think is possible and not possible, and you have to find some way through it. And the other party doesn't even think you're legitimate. They don't even think you have a right to rule. So you have a lot of problems. How are you going to deal with them? So the strategy that these presidents tend to take is they're rather slippery. They tend to triangulate. They tend to take a little bit from one side, a little bit from the other side. They tend to steal the other party's best ideas and reconfigure them and put them out in a different, and spin them in a different way. They basically are bobbing and weaving all throughout their presidency, and they're attacked viciously on both sides. Obviously, their opponents don't think they have any right to rule at all, but the folks in their own party think that they are sellouts. They think, why can't you just stand up to these people? And they are the group that is most viciously attacked often in history. Grover Cleveland, of course, subject to lots of attacks. And, of course, sometimes they succumb to their own problems. That was Richard Nixon. So that's preemptive president. And then we have the final one, and the final one is Jimmy Carter. Well, Jimmy Carter is the example of what we call a disjunctive president. Disjunctive means things fall apart. The center cannot hold. Things fall apart. Why? Well, when Jimmy Carter takes office in 1976, people are sick of the Vietnam War. They're sick of Watergate. They're sick of inflation. They're sick of all the bad things that have been happening in the 1970s. They don't like the oil embargo, all sorts of problems. And Jimmy Carter comes in, and he has to basically make this very old, creaky New Deal coalition work one more time. But what the problem is that he's very late in the regime, and he is being ganged up on by other folks in the Democratic Party. Teddy Kennedy is licking his chops and thinking, I could do a better job than this guy. And so he has a really difficult time keeping everything together, and he fails, ultimately. And this is the basic problem of disjunctive presidents. They come in when their regime is weak, and they can't keep all the factions of their party together. And what they try to do is they try to come up with an interesting way of basically making things work. And usually the way they do it is they say, I have a very special skill, expertise, that will allow me to basically make things work. So Jimmy Carter, he was an engineer. He was a technocrat. And the last one before him, like this, was Herbert Hoover. Herbert Hoover was also an engineer and a technocrat. So you see, it's just a matter of problem solving. I'm a pragmatist. I solve the problems. And then the earliest version of this is John Quincy Adams, who was one of the great diplomats in American history. And so that was his special skill. He was a diplomat. So that's what a disjunctive president. So you see this cycle? Now, they don't always have to go 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. Let's take, you know, the New Deal civil rights regime. You have FDR, he's the reconstructive president, followed by Harry Truman, affiliated. Dwight Eisenhower is a preemptive president, followed by John F. Kennedy, affiliated. LBJ, affiliated, followed by Richard Nixon, preemptive president, followed by Jimmy Carter, last in the line, disjunctive president, and then comes Ronald Reagan. So that's Goronic's story. It's a very interesting story. I find it interesting because the rise and fall of these regimes also marks the rise and fall of what people think is possible in the Constitution. What kind of issues get presented? Because the courts, you see, tend to correspond as a lagging indicator to these presidencies, because the presidents appoint members of the federal judiciary. And so if we're going to understand the nature of our time and what's happening in the Constitution, the thing we have to think about is, what regime are we in? And where are we in that regime? Are we early or late? So let's start with Barack Obama. Barack Obama wanted to be, I think, a reconstructive president. He wanted to bring hope and change. He wanted to create a new regime, the Obama regime. I think that's what he wanted to do. Certainly, when I listened to him talk during the campaign, that's what I thought. But when Obama became president, he very quickly ran into a buzzsaw of opposition. He had a tough time as president, enormous amount of opposition. And so it turns out by the time that he ends, it looks like he was like Woodrow Wilson or Richard Nixon or Dwight Eisenhower or Bill Clinton. He was, in fact, a preemptive president. That is, he was unable to end the Reagan regime. He was unable to end things and begin a new regime. And a lot of the way in which he worked reminds me of these preemptive presidents. He took the best ideas from the opposite side. That's Obamacare, really. It's a Heritage Foundation idea. He agreed that we needed to reduce the deficit, and so he did, sometimes against, right? He reduced the amount of government employees, and he did a whole bunch of things in foreign policy, which really are continuations of the second term of George W. Bush. And so what we find is somebody bobbing and weaving, faced with just amazing opposition and scorn and people denying that he even was a legitimate president. And he finishes a very successful domestic president, one of the most successful, really, I think, in my lifetime. But he did not create a new regime. So now we have a new president, Donald Trump. And now the question we have to ask ourselves is, who is he? Where does he fit in this story? There are four possibilities. Let's go through them. Well, one possibility is he's just like George H.W. Bush was to Ronald Reagan. Right? So we're still in the Reagan era. He's still a faithful Reaganite. He's still basically trying to make the Reagan vision work. He still believes in the shining city on the hill. He's still fighting the Ruskies. No, that isn't right. He's still doing what, you know, Reaganites do, right? So that's one possibility, is that he's an affiliated president. This doesn't look right. It doesn't seem right. He seems to be changing things. He seems to be making a break. He seems to be unorthodox or heterodox in important ways. So that doesn't sound right. The second possibility is that he's a preemptive president. That is, he's swimming against the tide of enormous opposition. Well, that kind of makes sense. And he's trying to create a third way, which is neither one party nor the other, and he's trying to create something new. So he's like Bill Clinton, maybe, or Barack Obama. But that doesn't seem right either. The reason why is he still says he's a Republican, right? And he still is behaving like a Republican in a whole bunch of different ways. He doesn't seem to be swimming against the tide of Reaganism. If anything, he seems to sort of be picking things that he likes and things that he doesn't like and just going forward as he wants. It doesn't seem to be a preemptive president, because that would mean that Obama had somehow, under our noses, he had created a new regime. I didn't notice that. So he's probably not that. Third possibility is that he's a reconstructive president. That's interesting from the standpoint of the Constitution, because it would mean that he is the next FDR. He is the next Ronald Reagan. He is the next Abraham Lincoln, whatever you want. And the argument would be something like this. This guy seems different than anybody we've ever seen before. He has enormous loyalty. He has a social movement behind him. He has huge rallies. Everybody tells me he won the largest electoral college victory in history or something like that. He's like he's something new. He's going to smash the old and replace it with the new. So if, you know, that's one possibility, is that he really is the beginning of a new cycle. And he's getting a lot of resistance, but people who start a new cycle always get a lot of resistance, and that's what's going on. There's something that's not quite right about that one either. Let me explain why I think it's not quite right. Generally speaking, the way this works is, if you're FDR, right, the Republicans have basically been controlling Congress and the presidency for a long time. As you come to power, your party basically takes over and gets a new majority. Or Lincoln, the Republicans were actually gaining before Lincoln is elected in 1860. So, in other words, if that were true, there would be this new party, the Trump Party, that he would be the leader of, like Lincoln is the leader of the Republicans, and they would sweep in to Congress in 2016, and he would be the beginning of this thing, you see, and he would basically disown Ronald Reagan and all that he stands for, and he would insist that he's tired of this originalism stuff, and he's not going to appoint any judges to the courts that think the way that Reagan thought or that Scalia thought, and that he's just going to do something completely new. Well, that doesn't sound right. In fact, what sounds like is that with respect to a lot of things, he's doing what you would expect traditional Republican presidents to do. He's deregulatory agenda, appointing originalists to the federal judiciary, and that's Mr. Gorsuch. He's basically taking stands on tax reform that seem very traditionally Republican. In other words, he seems like someone who's not rejecting Reaganism, but basically adapting it to a particular time, and he's adding a dollop of new stuff having to do with immigration, for example, and trade. That seems what he's going on. So that leaves us with a fourth possibility. The fourth possibility is that we're at the end of the Reagan regime, and he's Jimmy Carter. Now, that's weird. He doesn't seem a thing like Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter, very polite man, never insulted anyone if he could avoid it, worked on a nuclear submarine, you know, all that sort of stuff. But structurally, what I want you to think about is this. Jimmy Carter is trying to be a different kind of Democrat as he sees the New Deal civil rights regime running on fumes. And he says, we live in a time in which you can't trust anyone, Watergate and Vietnam. But I won't lie to you, and I won't tell you an untruth. That's what he said on the campaign trail. I'm a different kind of Democrat, and I believe in the American people, and I'm going to get past all this squabbling over ideology. I'm going to fix things. I'm going to fix things. And that's basically what presidents in this situation tend to do. They tend to say, I can fix it. I'm Mr. Fix-It. And often they come into power with support by their party. So when Carter was elected in 1976, Democrats control both houses of Congress. When Hoover was elected in 1928, Republicans control both houses of Congress. They had, in fact, since the early 20s. When Buchanan is elected, Democrats control both houses of Congress. Of course, when John Quincy Adams was elected, everybody was a Jeffersonian, so you can't really say anything about it, right? Because really, you know, the party system as we know it is just forming. But basically, the fact that he comes in with the Republicans controlling all the levers of power doesn't mean he's not in a weak position. The thing you have to look for, and the thing we have to know in order to understand what time we're in, the thing you have to ask yourself is the following. Is the party's coalition fragmenting and fracturing? Are people at each other's throats? Is it difficult for Republicans in Congress to work together? has the Republican Party split into different factions that now treat each other as traitors and no longer will work together for a common goal? That's the question you have to ask. We don't know the answer to this question yet. We can only look at the edges of what we see. On some things, one expects there will be no disagreement. On judges, I expect there will be no disagreement. But on other things, taxes, repealing Obamacare, EPA regulation, a whole bunch of other things, immigration even, you might start to see a fraying at the edges. And if you do, then in fact, we may have a disjunctive presidency on our hands. Another piece of information would be that Trump enters the world at a time when the Republican Party was already in a civil war. This was the problem that led to the debt ceiling crisis in 2011 and 2013, and the government shutdown in 2013, in which you had radicalized factions of the Republican Party that were at war with other folks in the party that didn't disagree with them very much about substantive issues, but disagreed very much about tactics, and disagreed about how to go forward. And there was a lot of fighting. In fact, they got rid of the Speaker of the House because there was so much fighting, and they required Paul Ryan to become Speaker of the House. I said in something I wrote in 2014, long before I even thought about Trump, that the Republican Party had 99 problems, and that it was going through either a civil war or a nervous breakdown. Well, you know, what's interesting is that Trump didn't solve that problem. If anything, he just displaced it. He added another group of people to yell at each other. This is what seems to be going on. Okay, well, we don't know yet what's going on, but it looks like what happened is this regime is running on fumes and we're about to get a new one. Everything that I've seen suggests that Trump is a disjunctive leader, and he's basically going to have trouble keeping everything together. But you know what? I guess I want to tell you something. I'm always wrong. They asked me to predict Supreme Court decisions. I'm always wrong when I do it. They asked me who was going to win the election. I was wrong about that. So when I say I see these signs, take it with a large grain of salt. Just understand that I'm telling you what I think is going on, but I'm always wrong. I'm the opposite of Cassandra. She was always right, but nobody listened to her. Some people listen to me, and I'm always wrong. So that's the reverse of Cassandra. Here's another reason why this Skowronek model may not be right. You see, Jimmy Carter doesn't seem anything like Donald Trump for one very important reason. Jimmy Carter didn't run as a demagogue. By a demagogue, I mean somebody who stirs people's emotions and gets them worried about, you know, other folks who are destroying their lives, runs against elites and says, the elites don't care about you, but I do, who says that there are a bunch of cosmopolitan elites who really don't care about you, but I'll take care of you, and I alone can fix the problems that face the country, and we can restore America to greatness. These are classic demagogic tropes. We actually have never had a president who ran that kind of campaign before. But we did now. And so we really don't know how this story that Skowronek is telling fits in such a world. It could be that what we have on our hands is the next Abraham Lincoln. We have on our hands a guy who basically just changes the rules of politics. He runs a particular kind of campaign, and that's the way things go from now on. But I don't know. The things to look for, though, the things I want you to think about, though, really have nothing to do with the degree of opposition that he gets from the Democratic Party. Because it doesn't matter. Any Republican elected would get an enormous amount of opposition from the Democratic Party. Forget about that. Pay attention to what's happening in his own party. Pay attention to whether or not somebody tries to stab him in the back. Pay attention to whether somebody tries to run against him from his own party in 2020. Paul Ryan, anybody? If that happens, then I don't think he's the next Lincoln. I think he's going to be a slightly different animal. What does this have to do with the judiciary and the interpretation of the Constitution? Well, let me tell you. The judiciary has a really interesting role in regime politics. As I said, it's got a lagging indicator. Lagging indicator because when a president comes into office, he didn't appoint any of the judges. And if the new president comes in, and most of the judges were appointed by the previous party, then the president's not going to like the judiciary very much, so he's going to attack them. So that's another reason to think, well, maybe Trump really is this kind of new president, right? Because, but here's the problem. The problem is he's basically got 110 judicial appointments and a Supreme Court appointment, and he's basically making the judiciary's fold with Republicans, too. So there's a very puzzling question as to how to understand his relationship with the judiciary. It doesn't seem to be the same relationship Reagan had, or that Lincoln had, or that FDR had the judiciary. It's just very puzzling. He's a puzzling guy. But there's one thing I can tell you, which is kind of important, and it goes something like this. Here's an indicator, a lagging indicator. As a regime progresses, and as the party, the dominant party, appoints more people, most people, to the federal bench, a very funny thing happens to legal intellectuals like me. So I'm going to tell a story on folks like me. They start out being for judicial restraint. But as the regime proceeds and more judges are appointed by their party, they start to get more excited about the idea of muscular judicial review. And we've seen this happen several times in history. When FDR became president, the Republicans had appointed most of the judges on the Supreme Court. And the basic arguments of legal intellectuals on the left affiliated with the new regime was judicial restraint. That's when you get West Coast Cotel, and then you get the Commerce Clause cases, right? And when Reagan took over in 1980, the idea was also judicial restraint. That is, judges were legislating from the bench, and it was important for them to respect the political process. But what's interesting is that as you go through history, from 1936 up through the 60s and 70s, liberals become more and more interested in exercising judicial power. Why? Because they appointed more judges. Same thing happens with the Reagan regime. As you appoint more judges, conservatives start rethinking their attitude about judicial restraint. And they believe that in order to protect important rights, First Amendment rights, religious freedom rights, structural rights like federalism and separation of powers, it's really important to use the courts to enforce the Constitution. So by the time you get to our period, everything's flipped. Liberals, my generation, are now all about judicial restraint, minimalism, taking the Constitution away from the courts. It's the conservatives who basically are defending a strong judiciary that will enforce federalism, separation of powers, religious freedom, free speech, and so forth, and so on, and so on. That tells me that we're not at the beginning of something new. It tells me that we're near the end of something, that we're in a late regime situation. Now, a lot of that has to do not only with how the courts are appointed, but also social mobilizations and with how the Supreme Court selects its docket. That is, what cases it hears. And the way the courts select their docket affects a great deal how courts exercise judicial review. Generally speaking, courts don't take a lot of cases in order to uphold them. Generally speaking, courts take cases, Supreme Court takes cases to reverse them usually. And so there's a connection between effective social mobilizations, the agenda of the Supreme Court, and the kind of decisions the Supreme Court adopts. That's why the agenda of the courts for the last 10 or so years has largely been one that has encouraged what we might call conservative judicial activism, or we don't use the word activism anymore, we use the word engagement. Conservative judicial engagement. And that would probably continue, I suspect, within the Trump presidency. I think we'll continue to see the idea that it's really important that the courts defend important constitutional values and that courts should not defer to the legislature. Certainly the liberal justices will argue that, but I suspect that in the new court with Judge Gorsuch, that will not be the view of the dominant view of the conservatives. That also is evidence that we're not at the beginning of a new regime. We're still in an old regime. Okay. There's one last thing I wanted to close with. So let me just sum up what I've said so far. I think the best way to understand what time we're in right now is to think about ourselves in terms of where we are in the length and the life of the regime of conservative politics that begins with Ronald Reagan's election in 1980. I think it's the best way to think about the problem and where we are. The question that's on the table is whether or not our new president, President Trump, is basically creating a new world, a new regime, in which he will be the leading actor, or whether or not he is the last in the line of Reaganites. That is, he's trying to hold together the Reagan coalition in the face of changing demographics, changing problems, factionalism with his own party, the possibility he'll get a stab in the back from somebody in his own party. That is, that's what it seems to me is the issue on the table. And that the question also, it has to do with what will be the fate of the judiciary. My prediction is that we're still going to have this model in which it's the conservatives more than the liberals that are interested in the exercise of judicial review, that the liberals are going to be all about passivity and judicial restraint. That's what I think is going to go on for some time. But there's a last thing. I'd say something about the classical writers and their view about republics. Okay. Here's what I want to say. At the very end of the Constitutional Convention, there is a very famous statement by Benjamin Franklin. You've all heard it. Somebody asked him, what kind of government has the convention given us? And he says, a republic, if you can keep it. But what most people don't know is that at the convention itself, he gives a speech which is related to that theme. And what he says in the speech is, this government, I expect, will do tolerably well for a while. I'm paraphrasing what he says. But then eventually, like all republics, it will become corrupt and collapse into tyranny because the public, having themselves been corrupted, will deserve no better kind of leadership. That's what he says. You don't hear that quote very often. But when Franklin is talking to the folks at the convention, they all understand what he's saying and where he's coming from. He's adverting to a very long history of an idea among the classical writers about republics. Their view was that republics, which require virtue among the citizenry and virtue among the people who rule, were delicate things that were easily corrupted and destroyed over time. And the time was the great enemy of republics. The idea was, when republics begin, there's an enormous amount of public-spiritedness. And people are devoted to the republic. The public, as even comes from the Latin, res publica, the public thing. People believe in the public interest. They believe in the possibility of working for the public good. Even people who oppose each other all believe this. And the folks who are in the republic, they're interested in serving the public good. But over time, people start becoming suspicious of each other. There's corruption. People start looking out for number one. They stop being interested in the public good. People fight with each other. And people start to lose faith in the possibility of working for a public good. They lose faith in the idea of the public thing that they're all devoted to. And when that happens, they no longer trust their leaders. They no longer trust each other. And at that point, that's the moment when demagogues arise. That is the standard classical story. The demagogue preys on the population's disbelief in the goodwill of others, in the population's disbelief in the goodwill of those who are elected officials. And the demagogue steps in and says, often very uncouth, bad-mannered, loud, annoying, the demagogue comes in and says, everyone is corrupt. Everyone is out to get you. You can't trust anyone. I alone can save you, and I will restore your former glory. That was the classical account of demagogues and how they rise to power. In fact, if you look in Federalist One, Publius, in this case Hamilton, you know the guy, he's on Broadway, right? Publius says, when these republics are destroyed, they usually begin by demagogues who pay obsequious court to the public and then end up becoming tyrants, which what he means is they flatter the public. They say, you're the real important people. You are the one who matters. You're the people who are being badly treated. He flatters them. He gets their trust. And then he abuses their trust. He betrays them. This is in the first of the Federalist Papers. And the concern about demagogues and tyrants and folks like Caesar and Cromwell, this idea is at the beginning of the Federalist Papers, and it's the end of the Federalist Papers. And so when Franklin said that at the end of the convention, they all nodded their head. They knew what he was talking about. They said, republics are delicate things. How can we preserve civic virtue? How can we reserve faith and trust and hope in our republic over time? And what the people who drafted our Constitution did was they decided that you can't expect people to be virtuous all the time And you can't expect public officials to be virtuous all the time. You can't expect a republic that's going to last for a long time to maintain this very delicate balance. And so what they did is they created a system of checks and balances and a system of federalism and a system of staggered elections, which makes it very difficult for any one party to control all the levers of power for a significant period of time. And they created an independent judiciary to watch over it and keep it in check. Now, I said before, we've never elected someone who ran specifically as a demagogue to be president before. Even Andrew Jackson doesn't seem to be the same as this fellow. Andrew Jackson had a very distinguished military record and had been governor of Tennessee, and he had done a lot of things in his life. This is a different kind of fellow. But you know what? Here, Steve is going to note how much of an optimist I am. The framers knew such a person would eventually arise. They knew such a person would eventually become president. They didn't think it wouldn't happen. They knew it would happen. They designed the Constitution precisely because they knew it would happen, because they wanted to create mechanisms that, if people followed them, would make it possible to make lemonade, dare I say, out of lemons. They realized that power is something that people grasp after. They realized that people lose faith and trust in their institutions. They wanted to create a system that would survive even those difficult and dark times. The question before us now, what constitutional time is it, is whether or not they prepared well enough. I think they did. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much to Professor Balkin. It's become our custom to take at least a couple of questions before the nice reception we have for you. If anyone has an inquiry after Professor Balkin's stimulating lecture, yes.
Professor Balkin, my understanding is that one of the mechanisms that the framers designed to protect against the rise of a demagogue, as you mentioned, is the Electoral College. Obviously, that's not working, or at least it didn't in this past election work in the way in which the framers intended. In an ideal world, what do you think should happen to the Electoral College? And in the real world, what do you think realistically can happen?
I think that the Electoral College idea was always a red herring. Very shortly after the Constitution gets started, it becomes quite clear the Electoral College is not going to play the role that people today often imagine it was supposed to have played. So I don't think anybody would have been surprised that at the time that the Constitution is adopted that the Electoral College didn't do what people hoped it would do. The major devices that the Constitution creates for checking power when people become untrustworthy or unscrupulous is the separation of powers and federalism. The separation of powers and also an independent judiciary. Let me explain a little bit more about this. Our separation of powers doesn't work the way that it was imagined because we now have separation of parties, not separation of powers, a point that Levinson and Pildes have made in an important article. So often when the president and Congress are the same party, they tend to help each other out instead of opposing each other. But on the other hand, separation of powers does matter in a bunch of ways because of the way that battles get fought out in the administrative state, in which, in fact, presidents can't do everything they want through the administrative state. And also it matters because of the separation of powers between the political branches and the judiciary. I'm about to go to a conference at the University of Texas where I'm going to speak about a book by Sam Zakharov called Fragile Democracies. And Zakharov's book is about his studies of countries all around the world and how they keep democracy going. He's mostly interested in democracies that have just started. But what he says also applies to democracies that are mature and are facing crises as well. And the point he makes is that one of the most important things that keeps a democracy going and allows for there to be regular rotation in office and allows for there to be a sharing of power is a strong independent judiciary. That feature of the system grew over time. It wasn't exactly what the folks imagined it would be, but it became a very important check on power. That is still with us. Federalism is still with us, not in the sense of doctrines of federalism, but in the idea that states and localities can be independent power centers. That if you're in the opposition party, you can be elected governor of your state. In fact, many of our successful presidents have been former governors from the opposition party to the White House. And that when one party dominates national politics, the other party tends to dominate in local and state politics. This is a feature of federalism that people often don't pay enough attention to. These things tend to balance power and check power. And they operate whether or not the people that we have elected are good or bad, virtuous or vicious, whether they are power-seeking and power-hungry or devoted public servants. They continue to operate, and I expect we'll see their operation in the next 4 years. So this is a great question. There are a lot of things in your question. I can't touch on them all, but I want to emphasize the importance of several things that you said. Here's the first thing. The Gorsuch nomination arises as a result of constitutional hardball. That's what my colleague Mark Tushnet calls it, by the Republican Party, in which they refused to consider anyone for the Supreme Court in the last year of Obama's presidency. Now, that is not consistent with the traditional norms of how the Senate behaves. It's what Tushnet calls constitutional hardball, where you basically stretch the norms in order to get your way, and then you risk the possibility of reprisal down the road. You're going to think I'm just a crazy optimist for saying it. But the fact they resorted to that tells me that something is very weak here. That is, that the judiciary was the last place that they could hold on, the Republican Party, that the judiciary has become crucial to the Republican Party. This was not true in 1980. In 1980, the Republican Party had the wind at its back electorally, and the judiciary was not the most important thing, but now it has become the most important thing. It's controlling the judiciary, which is like John Adams, really, in 1800 with the Midnight Judges. But that doesn't really answer your question. Here's another way of putting your question. Our democracy is sick. We don't have a fully representative democracy anymore. And there are attempts now to try to make it even less representative and to lock in partisan advantage.
It never has been representative.
What I'm saying is, make it less representative than it was before. I'm not making a claim that it's been perfect, but I'm interested in the question of retrenchment, not simply in the question of lack of progress. These are two different things. There is a great deal of distrust among the public about our elected officials in both parties, and a great deal of fear that our elected officials are not up to the task of governing, whichever party. That's the sign of a sick democracy. That's the sign of a democracy where people have lost hope and faith in the possibilities. And at the same time that's happening, people are trying to lock in partisan advantage so that they can maintain power. These are the conditions that lead to the rise of demagogues. So what you're reciting back to me is the very thing that I was trying to talk to you about. These are the symptoms of the disease. The question you are asking me, and it's an important question, it's the most important question, is can we make our way through this? Is there any hope? Yeah. There is, but the problem is that in the course of making our way through it, a lot of injustice is going to be done. It's not going to be a happy time. It's going to be a dark time. I believe we will get through it. I believe that when we write history 20 years from now, we will see this as a dark time, but we'll see it as a time we got through. But don't expect it to be sunshine and lollipops and rainbows. It's going to be very difficult. There'll be an enormous amount of strife. I hope, of course, that there won't be violence. But there has been violence in the past in American history, especially when institutions begin to break down. We had a discussion at lunch over whether or not we are in the midst of constitutional crisis, and in which I said we weren't. But Steve, of course, was pointing out that maybe we are, a long, slow-motion crisis, a crisis of faith. I think that's what your question is about. I think that's why I think it's the most important question.
Well, I'd like to thank Professor Balkin and tell you all that we have a very nice reception for you out in the NPR. Thanks very much.